What's up, everybody? Today is Wednesday, hump day, and I went down the rabbit hole yesterday, and I pulled together a bunch of Donald Trump videos from the 90s. Some of it's funny, some of it's not. And when I look at these videos and I look at the past, 6-7 years of him being in the political spotlight, I realize a couple different things. When you argue for the in Donald Trump's favor, when you argue that he was a good person, a good president, blah blah blah, I don't think that's the argument that anybody should make. I think the argument you should make is not about his moral character. It's not about his Christianity. It's not about his anything. I don't think he's a nice guy. I think he's an egotistical maniac. I think the guy has legitimate mental issues. But what you do argue for is the 4 years of his presidency, where the cost of gas was the lowest it had been in years, and our economy was stable, and people, in my opinion, were much happier. So those are the cases, or that's the basis of any argument in favor of Donald Trump as president, is it's about the economy, stupid. That's how it's always been. That's how it should be now. And if you don't recognize the difference in our economy from Trump to Biden, you have a legitimate issue that I can't help you with. But anyway, I've done a compilation of a bunch of videos. I don't know how long this thing's going to be, but here's Donald Trump from the 90s, interviews with different people in the media when they loved him. This is Gil. Thanks for watching, or thanks for listening. Please like, subscribe, share, and comment. Thanks a lot. We'll see you next time. Later.
So what did Donald Trump do? He wrote a book. That's what he did. And he called it Surviving at the Top. Some might say, what arrogance, what nerve. But his publishers have every reason to believe it will be a bestseller. Trump's name has been a magnet, and his first book, The Art of the Deal, was at the top of the bestseller list for weeks. Donald Trump may have his problems, but he's not a quitter. A lesser man might have thrown up his hands at the events of the last several months. Trump's answer is bravado.
Here goes nothing.
This spectacular display in April was a Trump extravaganza. But even fireworks couldn't vanquish the aura of red ink that clings to this most expensive casino ever anywhere. It's Donald Trump's billion-dollar Taj Mahal. It's been setting Atlantic City gambling records since this opening day, but it's still barely breaking even. And the Taj is draining revenues from the other two casinos that Trump owns. But the Taj Mahal's opening did steal headlines for a few days from the soap opera of Trump's personal life. First in February, there was the publicity over his separation from his glamorous wife of 13 years, Ivana. Add to that the spice of his friendship with an also glamorous model, the younger Marla Maples, and the tabloids had a field day. On the business side, there were growing financial problems. In May, Forbes magazine reported that Trump's financial worth had dropped by two-thirds to $500 million. In June, Trump missed a payment to the bondholders of his Trump Castle Casino in Atlantic City. The Trump shuttle, which he bought last year from Eastern Airlines, wasn't making a profit. Manhattan's largest tract of undeveloped land, all 76 acres of it, was just sitting there. Trump bought it 6 years ago for $95 million. It's still undeveloped, and there are no buyers in sight. Trump's bankers had a choice. They could force him into bankruptcy or loan him more money. They chose to lend, but the terms were harsh. He had to relinquish a great deal of control over his empire, and Trump had to either get his assets to produce more money or sell them. Assets like this jewel, the Plaza Hotel, marking its second year under Trump ownership. It's still struggling out of debt. Above it all, literally, sat a confident Donald Trump. From his 26th-floor office in nearby Trump Tower, he was reassessing his options. Trump's office wall is decorated with magazine covers of happier times, but there are none on his wall from the past several months, and Trump had recently been reluctant to see reporters. But as his new book reached the stores, today is the publication day, he agreed to talk with me. For it's particularly important to him these days for this book to be a success. Well, the new book is entitled Surviving at the Top. There are many people who would say, failing at the top?
Well, I think what the press has done is taken a situation where they see something and blown it to kingdom come. I've never seen anything like it. Whether it's a marriage, by the way, or whether it's financial, I've never seen press reporting as I have with regard to me. And I hope the general public understands how inherently dishonest the press in this country is.
As a member of the press, let me try to clear up some of the things which you say are untrue. You write in your book, "My bankers and I worked out a terrific deal that allows me to come out stronger than ever. I see the deal as a great victory, and eventually the rest of the world will too." Being on the verge of bankruptcy, being bailed out by the banks, skating on thin ice and almost drowning, that's a businessman to be admired.
You say on the verge of bankruptcy, Barbara, and you talk on the verge, and you listen to what people are saying.
I talk to your bankers.
Well, that's fine. And what do they say? I mean, you know, depending on which banker you're talking to, what do they say? The deal I worked out is in the process. The deal I worked out is something that I think is good for everybody. The economy is down the tubes. Nobody knows how bad the economy is. I listen to the people on Wall Street talking about the possibility of a recession. We're not in a recession. We're in a depression. Now, when you're in a depression, you have to sort of go with the punches. You have to go see your banks. You have to deal with people. You have to work things out. And there are a lot of people. Unfortunately, I'm the only one people write about. I mean, they don't write about other people.
You have a little more debt than most people. You're something like $3 billion in debt.
I also have a little more assets than most people.
Okay.
You know, it's a sort of an interesting phenomena. I have many friends. They are negotiating with their banks the same as I am. And I always say to them, how come you never get any publicity? You don't end up on the front page of the various garbage
tabloids. They weren't on the front pages to begin with. Well, they don't have 50 magazine covers behind
them. I'll tell you, they also don't end up in the Wall Street Journal, and I do.
Let's try to be accurate.
Go ahead.
Some of your friends have told us that you deliberately missed a payment on the Trump Castle debt so that you could negotiate this deal with the bank. Is that true?
Did I deliberately miss it?
Hmm.
In other words, did I just say I'm not paying it?
Yeah, because then I can deal with my banks and I can get short-term agreements over the long term.
Well, I don't want to comment as to whether or not I deliberately missed
the payment.
Why not? I think that the deal that's been worked out is a fair deal. The Castle is doing very well. It's starting to do really well. Atlantic City is in the midst of a recessionary area. People are not going down like they used to because they don't have the money.
And the Taj Mahal, which was going to save everything, is just about breaking even, and your other two casinos are down 20% from last year. You have debts to pay back.
Right.
You have huge loans to pay back. You say the country is in a depression. What makes you think that you can pay back those loans? And further, what your bankers have told us is that the only way you even have a chance is by selling that property out there totally, the Plaza.
Well, I don't know what the bankers have said. The Plaza is a very valuable property. Everybody told me, oh, you paid too much. Now they're all saying, what a great deal he made
on
the Plaza.
Not.
Well, I think you'll find that it's a great deal when the deal is all said and done. I mean, the Plaza is doing very well. The Taj Mahal broke every record. That doesn't mean it's doing well. But the Taj Mahal last month had the highest win in the history of casino gaming.
I know, but it still was not enough. It just barely broke even in terms of what it cost you.
It's doing record business, but it has to do probably more than record business.
Look, your bankers wish you well. When I talked to your bankers, they said, we hope he does it. What I am saying to you is, you did overextend yourself. Okay?
Go ahead.
All right. How are you going to get out of this mess, surviving at the top, when everything is down and you owe a tremendous amount of money? Are you going to sell that
plaza?
You know
why? Because I have great assets.
You're going to sell them?
The answer is because I have great assets and the assets are doing very well. Take the Trump shuttle. Take the shuttle.
Not enough to pay back your debt.
Other people owe money far in excess of what their assets are. They have lousy assets. I have great assets. I have the best
assets.
You've got
to sell
them
in order to pay back your bills.
Perhaps you have to sell some of them. No, I don't have to sell all of them. Perhaps I'll have to sell some of
them. Which ones?
I think it's unlikely the Plaza gets sold. I think it's unlikely the shuttle gets sold. The shuttle is doing very well. We started off with 12% of the market. We're up to 50% of the market. Now what happens with the fuel oil? I don't know.
Have you had any bidders? Anyone want to buy it?
Yes.
Why haven't you sold it?
Because I'm not satisfied with the price and because I'm not sure that I'm looking to sell the shuttle.
Suppose things don't turn up. They don't get better. and you have to sell them all. And you may, and you may. And you got the railroad yards on the west side. You can't develop them. They're sitting there. You got a lot of problems. Suppose it doesn't get better. Is it surviving at the top? Can you start all over again?
Yeah, I think it's surviving at the top, Barbara. If the economy goes further bad, and that's a possibility that can happen, I'd have to sell more assets. But the assets are world-class assets that have values far in excess of the debt.
You say in your book, and I quote, "The truth is that almost nothing in life is what it's cracked up to be, except the battle to get where you want to go." Well, many people disagree. They enjoy their work and their families. They have hobbies. They have interests. They don't think that, nothing in life is what it's cracked up to be. That's rather cynical.
Well, I think that a lot of people would disagree with that, and I think most people would disagree, and I think that's great. I mean, that's what it's all about.
Nothing you get or got or have is what it's cracked up to be?
Very little.
In your book, you say, success is so often a matter of perception. What do you think the perception of you is today?
I really don't know what the perception is. I think people see me as a fighter. I think people have always seen me as a fighter. They know that I don't take a lot of crap from people and from others, and my life would be a lot easier if I did, to be perfectly honest.
In the current issue of Vanity Fair, the author Marie Brenner says that you read from Hitler's collected speeches, My New Order, and that these are speeches that you seem to admire. What's your reaction? Do you have this book? Do you have these speeches?
It is the most ridiculous thing I've ever heard. A friend of mine sent me a book. A man who I think is Jewish, although I don't know, sent me a book. It happened to be that book. All of a sudden, Marie Brenner somehow found out that he had sent me a book. It is the most ridiculous thing I've ever seen, and I'm probably going to sue Vanity Fair over it.
The author Marie Brenner quotes you as saying to her, "When a man leaves a woman, especially when it was perceived that he is left for a piece of ass, a good one, there are 50% of the population who will love the woman who is left."
I do remember saying that. I don't remember having used those words. It's possible, but I believe that if a man leaves a woman for almost any reason, that particular person, the man, is going to be at a major disadvantage in terms of the public eye. There's no question about it.
Do you think that your marital problems with Ivana in some way caused some of this to happen?
Probably. Is there
a connection? What is the connection?
I think there was a... The publicity was so huge, so intense, so incredibly intense. I mean, 22 days in a row or something on the cover of the tabloids. It's never been anything like that, and it's disgraceful. And somehow, in a bad economy, people focused on me as opposed to everybody else. I signed a prenuptial agreement with Ivana. The reason for a prenuptial agreement is it takes away uncertainty. When it takes away uncertainty, it's quiet, it's nice, it's clean, everything. Well, Ivana decided to sue me on it. Brilliantly decided to sue me on it. So now she sued.
Brilliantly?
Brilliantly. Why sarcastically brilliantly? She decides to sue me on it. She's not going to win the suit. I thought it was dishonorable to do it, but she decided to do it. That caused tremendous turmoil, tremendous publicity, tremendous everything else. And I have no doubt in my mind that that was a very negative factor. There's no question in my mind.
There's some confusion as to your marital state. You're still married, but you've told friends that you'll probably be divorced.
I am still married. I don't know what the legal definition of marriage is, to be perfectly honest.
You don't know the legal definition of marriage?
The legal definition of marriage in this context. I am married. I don't know whether or not you'd consider it a separation. I can't tell you what's going to happen because I'm not even sure I know myself.
You've said in your book that Marla Maples did not cause the breakup of your marriage, that you and Ivana would have split anyway. But didn't it hasten it?
No.
That's
an absolute correct statement. Marla Maples is a friend of mine. I have a lot of other friends. Nobody caused...
You treat the other friends the same way as you treat Marla?
They had me going out with every woman
in the United
States.
We're not talking about that. We're talking about this one.
Marla Maples is a friend. I have a lot of friends. Did it hasten the breakup? Absolutely. In my opinion, absolutely not. The breakup was going to occur. And I'm not going to disparage Ivana. You'll never hear me disparage Ivana for one reason. She's the mother of my children. I'm not disparaging. But you grow apart.
While we're talking about Ivana as a mother, there have been reports recently in the paper, some of them attributed to Marla, that Ivana is not a good mother, that she has left her children this summer. But the truth is that she is with her children right now on a boat.
I think Ivana's a very good mother.
Okay.
Ivana's a good mother.
And also the truth is that you yourself said that you saw your children maybe once a week. You're having a lot of difficulties with your 12-year-old son, Donnie. You haven't talked to him since May. I mean, this is a very painful situation.
I am not going to disparage Ivana as a woman or as a mother.
You do say she is a good mother.
I say she's a good mother. I say that Ivana is fine. As far as myself, I think I'm a very good father. I've been a very good provider. And I guess you have to leave it like that, Barbara. I mean, what can I say?
Do you believe in fidelity in marriage?
Yes, absolutely, I do. Absolutely. I think that there's nothing better than a good marriage. There is nothing worse than a bad marriage. I'm absolutely a believer in marriage. I'm an absolute believer in fidelity. But if a marriage isn't working, that's a different ballgame.
I want to clear something up. In your book, the new book, you say the fun is in the getting, not the having. Does that include women?
No kidding. An interesting question. I think the hunt is always fun, whether it's deals, whether it's women, whether it's anything. I think, however, that with respect to women, there would be nothing that would make me happier than having a great marriage, an absolutely great marriage, and that would certainly supersede the hunt.
My colleague Diane Sawyer did an interview with Marla in which Marla said that she loves you. Do you love her?
I'm not going to comment on it. I'm not going to talk about it.
And that's where Trump drew the line. He's still in litigation with Ivana over the validity of the prenuptial agreement. Because of that, he said he would not discuss Marla any further. With all of this publicity and with the way that you have answered, there are people who say, why won't he show some humility? Why say surviving at the top?
Well, that means
why
a lot not? Of things. Surviving
well,
at the top.
I mean, you never say, I made mistakes. Gee, I'm in trouble.
Everybody makes
things
mistakes,
are bad.
Barbara.
You
I make
haven't
mistakes.
Said it.
I make mistakes. Everybody
I mean, people don't
mistakes.
Think you show any humility.
Well, I don't know. I mean, I think that I'm a rather, and you will be surprised, but I can be a rather humble person if I want to be, if I feel I'm in the right environment. You're always guarded. I'm not going to let my guard down because you happen to be asking me questions. You're somebody I know and have a great respect for, but I'm not going to let my guard down because Barbara's here asking me questions.
I can understand that. You have a brother whom you were very close to, Robert.
Right.
You had another brother, Fred Jr.,
right.
who died. Who just somehow couldn't make it in life. What did you learn from that, or did you?
Well, I think it relates to your previous question. I mean, Freddie was a great guy, had everything. He was very open, very much the opposite in a sense. He was very open. And because of this openness, he'd get himself into a lot of trouble. And ultimately, it was alcohol that just decimated him. It was a horror show. And it really took Freddie's life, alcohol. And I'm glad I'm not a drinker. I mean, I've never had a drink in my life. But frankly, you know, it gives you the opportunity, if you do, the negative opportunity, that if you do, it can really hurt you. And it hurt him.
Your brother was open, too vulnerable maybe, drank. Did this make you, I don't know, close up, keep it all inside?
I learned a lot of things from Fred. But I did learn for myself that I don't want to be open. I don't want to make myself vulnerable. I also learned that you have to do what you want to do.
You say, just wait 5 years. Look ahead 5 years. Where is Donald Trump?
I don't know. There's too many variables. You live for today, you do for today.
Is today okay?
Today's okay. Hey, today's not great. I mean, between a marriage and between all the struggles and between life and everything else, I mean, it's not like it's the greatest time of my life, but it's not the worst. I've had a much worse time in my life. And I live very much for the moment. I think the future is very important, but the moment is here. You don't know if you're going to be in the future.
Thank you.
Thank you.
So where do Donald and Ivana go from here? Well, Ivana is still running the Plaza Hotel, and she's in town taking care of her three children. Her future looks good, for she's handled the situation with discretion and has received many offers to come out with her own line of products. As for Donald, this week he received yet another blow when the New Jersey Casino Control Commission revealed that his financial empire is worth far less than he claimed last year. And further, if he had been forced to sell his assets this spring, they say he might not have realized enough money to get out of debt. Still, with all of his troubles, there's something very disarming about Donald Trump, and he possesses both courage and daring. Like him or not, the man is an original, determined to survive at the top.
Welcome to our broadcast. Tonight we spend the hour with a man who has already left his own unique mark on the face and history of New York City. If Donald Trump is not in the news for a high-stakes deal or a controversial new development, he may be in the gossip columns with his latest relationship. But less than 2 years ago, the news was that the Trump empire was in trouble, and some were quick to announce that the king had lost his crown. Donald Trump, some say, is out to prove them wrong and is currently writing his third book, which is The Art of the Comeback. And that's what we want to start with. Donald Trump is here, and I'm pleased to have him. Welcome.
Hi, Charlie.
Nice to have you here.
It's been a long time.
It has. We're in New Orleans, back during the Republican convention, in a little room talking about, the challenge of the Japanese at that
time. Exactly right. Yeah. Exactly right.
Now, here is Trump, The Art of the Deal, and this is Trump surviving at the top. Right. And here is the Casino Journal saying, gaming's greatest comeback. Here is, guess what, casino player, the comeback kid, Donald Trump's amazing turnaround. And here is New York Magazine out this week, fighting back, Trump scrambles off the canvas. Bill Clinton, after the New Hampshire primary, went out front of and had a press conference, and he said, even though he came in second, said, I'm the comeback kid.
That's right.
And look what happened to Bill Clinton.
Right.
Now, if you could translate that for you, where would it be? Where would it take you to? What would be the equivalent of reaching the White House for you?
Well, I think just doing what I'm doing, Charlie. You know, I've had a really great streak over the last year. A lot of people went down. The economy is in a horrible condition, just a deplorable condition. The politicians destroyed the economy in 1986 when they passed a tax law that just destroyed the real estate industry, which in turn destroyed the banks and the savings banks and savings and loans. And I really got very lucky in a way. I built the Taj Mahal, which everyone said that's going to be his downfall. The Taj Mahal, it's over a $1 billion building. And it's turned out to be one of the best deals I've ever made. It broke records for the last 3 months. It won over $40 million a month. No casino in history has won anywhere near that. All three of my casinos were rated 4 stars by the Mobile Travel Guide, and they're the only casinos in the United States that are so rated. So, you know, it's really been an incredible period of 6 or 7 months for me, and it's really been gratifying. Now they all want to do the comeback stories and everything else, and I think I probably care less about that than I would have maybe 3 or 4 years ago. But it's been a pretty good experience for me.
Then how are you different than you were 3 or 4 years ago?
Well, I used to say, and in fact, I think I said in my first book that, and maybe this was foolish, but I really meant it, that someday I'd like to maybe lose everything for a period of time to see who's loyal and who's not loyal. And I found out a lot of
Did
things.
Did you find out who's loyal and not loyal?
I tell you what, and you can't guess it. You can't predict it. You think certain people would be loyal no matter what. And it turns out that they're not, and you just can't predict it. It's very difficult.
What hurt the most?
Well, it's a whole different scene, Charlie. I mean, we have a situation where you have everything going perfectly, and then one day you wake up and the world is coming to an end from the standpoint of the economy. But I just think that I've had a lot of luck. I've had a lot of friends. I've had a lot of good friends. And overall, I've done really well with it, and I'm very happy about it.
All right, now help me go back and understand what it was to be you and what happened. So the economy did, you know, you were hit and other real estate developers, and some people have not been able to come back. Some developers in Canada and in the United States who had a magnificent reputation for quality and for the deal are still in bankruptcy, in fact. How high did it get for you? I mean, what was it like for you before the crash, and then how low did it get for you when things began to go bad and people were counting you out and saying that not only could you not recover, but that you were that far from bankruptcy?
Yeah. Well, I never thought I was that far from bankruptcy, but a lot of people were giving me a hard time. And I think overall, Charlie, it was an experience that I don't think I want to go through it again. I have to tell you this. I mean, you know what it's like. It's you're really in a position where I think that if you had to do it again, I'm not sure you could. I went through a period of 2 years that was truly tough.
But in what way?
Well, you know, you have parents and you have people that adore you and you have people that for 15 years, nothing went wrong. And then all of a sudden, the world seems to be coming to an end. I mean, it just seems to be coming. And it's just, it was just sort of an incredible experience for me.
Did you have to go to your father and say, bail me out, help me. Help me get through this crisis one more time.
Right. My father wouldn't have been in a position to bail me out, but he certainly helped. And, you know, morally and in any way he could. My mother was great. I have a sister who's a federal judge, and she's very, very strong. She's a fantastic woman. I never knew as to loyalty whether or not she'd be there or wouldn't be there. And she was there in spades. Other people were there. But, you know, the incredible thing is you can't really tell. You can't really tell who's going to be there, who's not. I would have bet my life on certain people. I would have said, politically speaking, that somebody that you know, Andrew Stein, would have been there. And he wasn't. I would have said that other people...
He wasn't there for what?
He wasn't there in terms of... For 15 years, I supported Andrew Stein. Supported him. I never asked him for a thing. When I needed a vote on Riverside South, until the very end, when everybody else was on board, Andrew was not there. And I was really surprised at that. Now, ultimately, he was there. But it shouldn't have been so difficult. Right,
Here comes one of the things they say about you is that there are ticks within you, a vindictiveness about that. And you're not going to forget that. And part of the Trump style is to, at some point, you're going to try to get Stein back.
Well, I don't think I'm going to try and get Stein back. I'm just disappointed. I'm disappointed in other people. And I'm not disappointed in some. I mean, there have been people that were... Much more, a man like Alan Greenberg of Bear Stearns, right, who would call me every day during the trauma.
What would he say?
Well, he'd just call me and it'd boost me. He'd say, just keep fighting, just keep fighting. You know, he's really a phenomenal guy and a great leader, and that's why Bear Stearns, I mean, without any big parent company, I mean, Bear Stearns has just done tremendously well. But Alan has been a really loyal friend, and I've had a lot of other loyal friends. But the thing, and I guess I'm going to go into this in the third book, I do one book, it's a bestseller. I do another book, it's a best and number one bestseller. Both books were number one. And I think, frankly, I think this is the best book. I think this will be the best book because I really believe I know much more now than I did for the other two. I've learned about hardship, something which really I didn't know. I went to the best school. I did great. You go to the Wharton School of Finance. You go through it easily. You do fantastically well. Everything goes smooth. You get out of school, you make a lot of money, every deal works out. It was sort of like just a series of you couldn't make a mistake.
Did you think you were invincible at that time?
I never thought I was invincible because I've seen too much and you have to learn from history about others. So I never thought I was invincible. But I had a 15-year run that was, you know, virtually unprecedented. I had a tremendous run. And all of a sudden, 1990 hit. And I remember there was an article, Welcome to the 90s, Donald. But 1990 hit. And the economy was crashing, yeah, and the banks were crashing, and everything was crashing. And what happened is I learned a lot about myself, and I learned a lot about other people.
Okay, but you keep saying I learned. What did you learn about yourself?
Well, I think I learned for real that I'm a pretty tough guy, because you really, it takes a tough guy. Hey, it takes the brains, and it takes the this, and it takes it, but it also takes a toughness, because to go through a period of turmoil, where everything seems to be going in the wrong direction, and survive it, and end up, as they say in the, my new magazine covers are coming back.
Well, but what they say here, what Greenberg said, is that Trump went from owning 100% of nothing to 50% of something that's making money.
Yeah.
Fair?
Well, I think that's what he said, and he actually said making a lot of money.
That's right.
What's happened?
He did say that.
What's happened is that the casinos have turned out to be tremendous for me. And again, a lot of people were criticizing the move into the casinos and all, but they've really turned out to be tremendous. Real estate in New York is starting to come back on a very slow basis. I don't know how long it's going to take. I think it's going to take a long time. But the casinos in particular have been fantastic. But, you know, it's just worked out for me. It hasn't worked out for a lot of other people.
Yeah.
And I think a lot of that has to do with an inner strength, and that's what I'm going to be writing about. A lot of it also, though, has to do with other people, the loyalties of other people, how you treated other people so that maybe they are loyal.
Did it split the family?
No.
Did it cause division between you and your brother?
It didn't cause division. I was a little disappointed in my brother. I thought he would have fought harder than he did. I was the opposite of my sister. I have a sister who is really a phenomenal lady, and she really...
This is the judge.
The judge. And she really was just tremendous. My other sister, likewise, was tremendous. My parents have always been, and I would expect them to be. You know, it's interesting. One of my attorneys said, always count on your mother. Now, I maybe took advantage of my mother. I never appreciated her as much, but she was really fantastic.
Well, it is also said you came out in defense of Mike Tyson, and you came up with these community, and it is said that your mother said, enough, Donald, shut up.
I think that's probably the first time my mother absolutely got angry at me. I really mean that. I mean, my mother was so crazy when I came out in defense of Mike Tyson. And part of the reason I came out
of defense... Your mother's 80-something.
My mother's 80 years old, right. And part of the reason that...
tough enough to survive a mugging.
Oh, she's tough. She's tough, but she's quality. I mean, more than tough, she's quality.
So she said what?
Well, she wasn't... she didn't exactly like the fact that I was defending Iron Mike, but I watched what happened to Mike Tyson. I watched how badly he was represented by an attorney in Washington that was charging him $3 or $4 or $5 million against a local attorney, the best within 100 miles that the state hired, who just ate the other man's lunch. And I watched the way he did it, and I watched, or I heard about a girl that late in the evening knocked on his door, was taken in, was raped, perhaps, perhaps not, I don't know. I mean, I don't know. Again, I think he was very badly represented. But I did see that, number one, she knocks late in the night. Number two, she's dancing in a beauty contest at 8 in the morning, and I saw the tapes, and I see the big smile on her face, and she's dancing happily at 8 in the morning. And now Mike Tyson's in jail for 4 or 5 or 6 years. I had a real problem with that case. I had a real problem with Mike Tyson's lawyers. I had a real problem with Don King. I just think that he was really fed out to the wolves.
But if, in fact, he raped her in that hotel room, regardless of whether she came there, you think that he should have been convicted and should have gone to the slammer.
He, to this day, denies it. I don't know that it happened. And I think that, as they said, if he didn't testify, he would have been exonerated totally. The jury said that. Mike was arrogant. He was a horrible witness, from what I understand. And I'm not surprised. I mean, I would say that, generally speaking, you don't put Mike on as a witness. But he was a horrible witness. And to get 4 or 5 or 6 years, I think that there was just too many circumstances. Again, she was in a beauty contest, and she was dancing with a big smile on her face at 8 o'clock in the morning. 8 o'clock in the morning.
Yeah, but the jury sat there, and they listened to her, too. They had an opportunity to hear her and test her credibility as they heard it, and also to face questions. This guy's not a bad lawyer. He may have handled his case bad, but he is the same man that represented John Hinckley and others and had an extraordinary reputation in a very good Washington firm.
I watched Mike, and I've been with Mike, and I've seen him, and people really take advantage of this man. And I want to tell you something. I think this is one of those examples. Now, I know we have a system of juries, and I know we have a system where if you're found guilty, you're guilty, but somebody like me, maybe who has a little bit more independent streak, can say, hey, Mike Tyson, in my opinion, should really be given another break. I mean, they put him in jail before he was even guilty, as far as I was concerned.
Do you believe he'll fight again, and do you believe he'll ever be the heavyweight champ again?
I think he'll fight again. I don't know that he'll be the heavyweight champ again. In the prison that he's in, they don't allow boxing. That's a long layoff.
Yeah.
Some of the young fighters that are coming up in the heavyweight division are great.
There's but Lennox. Ali came back from the years
well,
that he
Ali
was off.
Ali came back. Ali was totally unique. He was a unique man, and maybe Mike will come back. I think Mike probably will be the champion again, but you have some young fighters coming up, heavyweight fighters like Lennox Lewis, who is absolutely phenomenal.
You think Holyfield's going to lose?
I think Holyfield, I'm not sure if he's going to lose now, but I think your next champion is going to be Lennox Lewis.
Boy, he sure did a number on this.
No, he was incredible.
In London
I want to
the other
tell
day.
You. I mean, he knocked out.
First
in
round, wasn't it? Or
second round.
Round.
And this gentleman went 18 or 20 rounds with Mike.
Well, that was his claim to fame, that he survived being in the ring with Tyson.
Lennox Lewis is probably the real thing. I mean, he could be the first real thing since Mike, and it'll be interesting. And he's younger, and he's this and that. Or,
what is your fascination? Are you an athlete?
I am pretty much of an
scratch
athlete.
Golfer or close to
scratch golfer.
You mean like you do par 72, 73
yeah,
on good courses?
On good courses.
Yeah, up against good players?
Up against good players.
For money or not for money?
Well, I like playing for money because it gives you an interest. I mean, it really does. Golf was something that really helped me through a period. When I was really, you know, there's a point at which you can't push. You have to sort of sit back and wait and see how the chips are falling.
And during the adversity period.
During the
was
adversity
it.
Period. And I'd go out on the golf course, and sometimes I'd go out with some friends who were good golfers, and you'd play. And you really don't think about all of the problems of the world and the problems of everything. And again, you know, I like to blame myself, but I mean, one of the things is, frankly, I was doing so well and it was all so easy that I took it easy. And all of a sudden, I started relying on other people, and I said, listen, you went to the Wharton School of Finance, you're a genius, you take care of this, and you take care of that, and you do this. And I stopped, and I got rid of people, and I did it myself. And since then, things have been fantastic. I mean, it's just
92 is the best year of your life?
I think 92 could be certainly one of the best years of my life because it really all came together for me, financially speaking and in so many other ways.
I read all these numbers, and this is not investigative journalism here. We're interested in what makes you tick, and we don't have the resources or the manpower or the time doing a nightly show to do what somebody would do if they spent 6 months working on a piece about you.
But you do have the brain. So
help me with the numbers. Do you owe $5 billion?
No, at one point, I guess I owed pretty close to $5 billion, but I had assets far in excess of that.
Yeah.
And they passed a 1986 tax law, which was just absolute stupidity by the politicians.
But a lot of people supported that. Garman and Baker and Bill Bradley and a lot of other people thought this was the Tax Reform Act of all time.
Yeah, I like
and
Bill
Jack
Bradley.
And Jack Kemp, too, did he not?
I like Bill Bradley, and I like a lot of the people that you mentioned, and they didn't really support, but Bill Bradley did very much.
Bradley was.
And I have to tell you, he destroyed the home building industry in the United States. He destroyed the savings and loans in the United States.
The Tax Reform Act of 86
Absolutely. What happened is incentive was taken out of the real estate industry. And the industries, such as savings and loans, they're based on real estate. And when the values went down, and they plummeted, they absolutely plummeted. So the savings and loans had billions of dollars in real estate that now all of a sudden is one-half the billions of dollars in real estate.
Yeah, but you know better than I do is that during that time, the savings and loan crisis came about because a lot of savings and loan lent a lot of money to developers that were bad loans and should not ever have been made. And then
Charlie,
all of a sudden...
That's true. And I have to tell you, it's 100% true. But a lot of that was exacerbated. A lot of loans that could have been good loans were made into bad loans because of the change, because of the 1986 tax law change. And what that did is all of a sudden you had resolution trust and you're paying billions and billions. In order to save $5 billion in taxes, we're now paying trillions of dollars to save industries and save banks.
And some people have come along and made a ton of money because of the resolution trust.
And some people made a lot of money.
Didn't I see where Ron Perlman the other day made $1 billion or something?
Well, I don't know what he made, but I frankly, he's a good man. I hope he did make a lot of money. But it's the government's fault. The government passed a very stupid law. They have to put the incentive back into real estate. I think they're doing it. I think they're going to do it. It creates
jobs. Here's the other side. It is that people with great entrepreneurial gifts, like you, get yourself extended too far, too much debt and too much extension. And then when, as it happened in America, there is a business cycle. And when the economy goes up and goes down, if you get yourself extended too far and you've got a huge debt service, all of a sudden push comes to shove and you find yourself in a very, very, between a rock and a hard place. And it's that, the extending yourself too far, that causes so many people to come to ruin.
Well, I think you're right. I mean, I think I'm not going to, you know, not take blame for that. I think everybody takes blame for that, because anybody that does anything, the only people that don't get in trouble are the people
that don't do anything. If you play it safe and no risk, then there's no reward.
I mean, when I do things, I built the Taj Mahal. They said $1 billion building. How can it possibly? And now it's turned out to be tremendously successful. It takes time. You got to be able to get over the hump. Riverside South is going to be a tremendous
successful. Well, let's stop at Riverside South, though. Okay. I mean, first of all, what did you... Here is one of the arguments made about Riverside South, that you faced a huge opposition on the part of the Planning Commission. A lot of people who did not want to see a huge development over there. You turned it around, and most people give you the credit for turning around. So, you know, was it 9-0? How many people on the commission?
Well,
I don't remember.
12-0 vote.
12-0 vote. How did you do it, and did you make so many concessions in doing it that it no longer is an economically viable project?
Well, the only way you can talk about viability is what's going to happen with the market. Today, nothing's viable.
Gotcha.
Okay, today, nothing is viable. You could have the greatest piece of land in the best location in New York, and nothing's viable. When I did the Grand Hyatt Hotel, I will tell you, the hotel market was in shambles. Everybody said, Donald, you're crazy. And I was crazy, and I did it. And all of a sudden, I got it zoned. I started building it. And by the time it opened, it was a tremendous job.
Yeah, but would it have been successful without the zoning and the abatement?
No, it wouldn't have. I mean, it wouldn't
have.
But
so
I got the
concession.
Zoning.
Yeah, of course
Absolutely. And now what we're doing is we're asking for certain things in order to make Riverside South successful. We have tremendous popularity. Every civic association virtually in New York is supporting it.
But they're supporting it because of the concessions you made in terms
yes.
of subway,
oh, no.
in
I'm
terms of
park,
how much
I'm
parks, and all of that kind of thing. And so the question remains,
well, the bottom
can
line,
you deliver on it?
Yeah, the bottom line is if the market comes back, you deliver. If the market doesn't come back, you don't deliver. Now, maybe Clinton's going to come up with a housing program where you're getting a subsidized housing or something, in which case you do it in a different way. We're looking to get zoning for a piece of land that's unzoned, that's employing no people, that's sitting there rotting, that's rat-infested. Right. And if I get the zoning, which I hope to be able to get, the city desperately needs the job. If the city turns around, and if the economy turns around, and if incentives are put back into real estate on a federal basis,
No,
there's always ifs, but there's been ifs in everything I ever did. When I did Trump Tower, in all fairness, people said I was totally crazy. It couldn't possibly succeed.
Right,
it was too big, it was too expensive, it was too everything. And it turned out to be probably the most successful condominium development ever in this country.
And is it profitable?
Trump Tower?
Yeah.
The most. I mean, it was the most successful development ever built in this country on a condominium basis. I will tell you, 2 years before I started construction, people thought I was totally crazy to do it. It really worked out to be fantastic. You can say the Taj Mahal, you can say Trump Plaza. I mean, so many of the jobs I do at the time I'm doing them are supposed to be not good, and they turn out to be tremendous.
Who makes the decision as to when you go? Is that a decision made by you, or is that a decision made by the bankers?
No.
And are you going to parcel those projects off?
I'll tell you what, the city is lucky to have the bankers that I have on my job, because they've invested a lot. They have confidence in me, they have confidence in the city. And frankly, they're very lucky, because otherwise it could be a war, it could be a this, it could be a that, and that would be bad for everybody. I mean, I have some really great banks on this particular site, and they've gone with me, and they believe in me, and you know, and I'll tell you what, I think ultimately the decision's going to be right, and it's going to be a great success.
You know what they say, when you owe as much money as you did, they become your partners.
Yeah, but that's really a false statement, because Reichman owed a lot more money than me, and nobody's partners with Reichman. Reichman's in deep trouble.
Are they in bankruptcy? I want to be fair to them.
They are in bankruptcy, and frankly, they're in, you know, just very deep trouble. The banks, my banks have had a great confidence in me. They know I'm good. They know I do it the best, and they also know that I'm honest.
Have a choice?
Oh, absolutely.
They had a lot of money. I'm
not saying I would have been easy had the other route gone, but I will tell you this. They absolutely had a choice, and they could have gone a different route.
What's the route they could have gone?
Well, it could have been a contentious route. Rather than working and, you know, working with me, et cetera, it could have been a contentious route, and that would have been bad for me, would have been bad for them.
They could have put you up against the wall and said, you owe us this money, you can't pay it back, we call the tune.
They could have done that, and I think if they did that, it would have been bad for everybody, including them, and I think they understood that. But more importantly,
bad for them because they would have lost money.
Very much, right. I think so. I found out a couple of things about banks. First of all, I find the banks to be very, very underrated in terms of the intelligence level, the whole thing. I mean, I have worked with the banks now very closely for a period of 2 years, and these guys have done a fantastic job, at least as far as my stuff is concerned. I've done great for them, and they've done great for me, and my thing is back. I mean, I believe that in 6 months, in 12 months, I may be stronger than I was 2 years ago or 3 years ago. I think I will be stronger than I was 2 or 3 years ago. I would like to see an uptick in the market. I think you're going to have an uptick in the market.
Why do you think you'll be stronger? I mean, now that you clearly have given up equity.
Very little equity. What have I given up? You know, the story is that I gave up equity. What have I given up?
I sold the shuttle
for a lot of money.
You made more money than you sold it for more money than you paid for, or
no,
not?
No. I'll tell you what.
If you sold it for a lot of money, but sold it for less than
I reduced my debt by hundreds of millions of dollars by the sale of the shuttle, and
but
it worked
out. You sold
out
it for less than you paid for.
No, I didn't.
You didn't.
I actually sold it probably for more than I paid for it, but it's a very complex formula. Okay. If you sit down with a pencil and paper, we can maybe figure it out someday. In 5 years, because it's a long-term deal. We don't want to bore everybody with it. But I sold the shuttle. I got rid of a tremendous amount of debt. I got rid of a lot of personal guarantees. The Taj Mahal,
are unsecured loans from friends or what?
Personal guarantees meaning personal guarantees to banks. Where I personally guarantee a piece of a loan. If you take the Atlantic City properties, I have up to 80% of the Taj Mahal. It's the thing's making a fortune.
Making a fortune? Stay with me and ask this question. Is it making a fortune, or is it generating a fortune in revenue, but it has a fortune plus in expenses?
No, it has a big fortune in expenses. I mean, it's run first class. It's a four-star hotel.
Okay, but that's the point. Then how much of this in the end is net cash flow?
Well,
it simply that a lot of money is flowing in, but also out the other door is a lot of money going the other way?
I mean, I'll give you an example. We'll have probably $80 million in interest. I think the Taj could have a cash flow of maybe $30 to $40 million after debt.
Yeah.
That's some cash flow. Now, that's a great cash flow. Now, what do I do with it? I do with the West Side Yards, I do the Riverside South, I do other things. But the Taj Mahal's turned out very successfully. Trump Plaza, I own 100% of Trump Plaza. You know, there's this misnomer that I sold, I this, I that. I sold very little. I mean, when you think of it,
Would your friend Greenberg from Bear Stearns say he used to own 100% of assets that were worth nothing? Now he owns 50% of things that are making a lot of money.
Well, what happened in Atlantic
City?
Well, there is a difference. And I own 50% of the castle.
Right.
But when I say I own 50%, I'm also paying much less interest because I sold 50% to bondholders.
Right.
And in return for that, I got a reduction in debt, a reduction in this, and a reduction in interest. So it's making a lot more money. In Trump Plaza's case in Atlantic City, I own 100% of it. And that is turning out to be fantastic.
I take your word on all of this.
By the way, Charlie, I have to tell you, because of the fact, and a big difference is, and that's why you see in all the casino things, because of the fact that
they want to see you as a winner, because if you're a winner, it means that they're a winner.
Well, they don't want to see me as a winner, actually, because I have to tell you, when things started going bad, I was on the cover, but instead of my hands being up, I had my chin down, okay? Nobody wants to see me be a winner.
Let me just stay with that image for a second. Was it embarrassing for you?
No.
They say about you, they took his toys away. They took his yacht away. They took his...
Nobody took it away. I sold my
yacht. But, I mean, did the banks put you on an allowance or not?
No.
I mean, help us understand how bad it got for you and whether you were embarrassed and whether you said, wow.
Well, when you say embarrassed, I didn't love waking up in the morning and walking out the street.
But help us understand that. You were a guy who was the big winner, and all of a sudden the papers front of stories that saying, Trump in trouble. Trump, golden boy, no longer has Midas touch.
Right. You know, I'll tell you what the hardest part is, and the hardest thing about life to understand. In baseball, if you get 15 runs in the first inning and you don't get any more runs, you still have 15 runs at the end of the game.
Well, it depends on what the other guy does.
Well, no, but generally speaking, you're going to win that game, okay? You know, it's as sad as it is to say, but you're going to win that game. You get 15 runs, it's pretty well over.
Ask the Atlanta Braves.
Okay, I mean, we've seen some examples, but anyway.
In life,
I was 15-0, and then I had one very bad year. Now, I had a bad year. Maybe it was my fault because, hey, it was a lot of people's fault. It was also the government's fault. It was a lot of people's fault.
You take some responsibility, though.
Absolutely.
You're not saying.
Because I'd be a fool if I didn't. But I have to tell you, a lot of smart people
are
in real deep trouble right now, and I'm not. And a lot of people, really smart people, are dead. They're gone. They're buried. They're over
and
the history.
And one more time, why are they dead, buried, gone, history, and you are alive,
before I explain that, I just want to say that you have 15 great years, you have one bad year, and people judge you by your last thing. You're only as good as your last thing. You're only as good as your last article or what you've done lately. And that's it. I mean, you take a guy like Harry Helms, I mean, the man had 50 great years. Then, unfortunately, he married Leona. I mean, this was like a major mistake.
Here we go again.
He marries Leona. Yeah, poor Harry. I feel so sorry. If you're Harry, get rid of her. Just leave her alone. Find a new woman if you can. But I'll tell you what, he marries Leona. So now, all of a sudden, he has a couple of bad years, to put it mildly, bad years. I mean, we're talking about major. They don't say the score is 50-2.
Go ahead.
No, they don't say the score is 50-2. As far as they're concerned, Harry is like this major failure, and that's a shame because that's not the way life should work. It should be 50-2. That's a pretty good record. Well, I had 15 great, then I had the one bad year and one and a half real bad years where I had a fight. I mean, it was a struggle. It was a survival. It was surviving at the top. I wrote the book. It was surviving at the top. And it wasn't easy and it wasn't pleasant.
Did you ever think you'd lose? Did you ever lose confidence? Did you ever say,
no,
I may not get out of this?
No.
Not once.
And the reason I didn't say it is because I had to go back and do it myself. You see, I built what I built myself. And I did it by working long hours and working hard and working smart. More importantly than anything else is by using my own brain. And there was a point where I was making so much, so fast, and it was so easy that I almost got bored. And it's true. And I write about this. Yeah. I mean, I'm writing about this. It's really been an experience.
I should believe you here saying, in a way, this was good because it gave me a chance to test myself. The adversity was good. It put me back and made me leaner and hungrier again because everything was at stake and therefore I had to pay attention.
Well, I think I'll look at it in the future as being good. And when it was happening, I had no choice. I just had to do it, and I did it myself. And all of a sudden, I'll give you an example, Riverside South. I've had Riverside South for 5 years. I've had the land for 5 years. I went through a succession of executives that were in charge of Riverside South. A year and a half ago, I took it over myself. And as you say, I got a 12-0 vote, and you were told that I sort of did it myself. I did do it myself.
Read that you did, right.
Okay. I mean, you can't believe everything you read. But I did do it largely by myself with a group of people. But I really spearheaded something that's turned out to be, I think, going to be a great thing. I really went back to work, and I really did things myself. And I think that's why I survived, and I think maybe, who knows?
Let me point out a couple of other things here this time. You lost during this period. 3 key executives.
Correct.
Who died in a helicopter crash.
And friends
who were running. And then you went through some executives after that and finally put your lawyer in charge down there, right?
Who's done a great job.
You had a divorce that was, you were the fair to say people were laughing at you about this divorce. And we were amused in the tabloids. I was living in New York at the time, but we were amused by it. But at the same time, some people said, enough of this. I'm tired of reading about this kind of stuff.
I would have loved to say enough. I mean, I couldn't help it. It was
yeah, but you were feeding the columnists, too.
I wasn't feeding. I mean,
you had no conversation with all these people?
You know, it wasn't a feed. It wasn't a feed. It was a frenzy, I have to tell you. And I wasn't feeding anybody. They were feeding themselves. They were making up stories. I called up one of the top people in one of the New York tabloids, and I said, hey, look, this is ridiculous. This story didn't happen. Don't put it in. He said, I know it didn't happen, but Donald was selling papers like crazy. And they knew it before the story was written. They put it in anyway. And I think for 28 days in a row, I mean, you know, we talk about Woody Allen was a big story. This thing just swamped everything.
Okay,
this swamped everything. This was the biggest of the big. It was crazy. It was out of control. And I guess it had all the elements of a soap opera.
Did it bring any satisfaction to you that during this adversity you were able to get out of the marriage? At a time, perhaps you gave up a lot less money than you might have imagined you would do at another time. Now,
well,
come on, tell
yeah,
me the truth.
I mean, a lot of there were those people that say that I did this purposely in order to get out of the
divorce. But there are those who said that you used that adversity as a time to say, you know, it may not ever get any better, so you better, you know, people were saying you better make your deal now.
Yeah.
True.
I was very happy to pay Ivana what I paid her. I mean, this was what I was supposed to pay her, and this is what I did pay her, because she, if anything happened a year ago where I went down the tubes, where I really would have ended up with nothing, she and the children would always have been taken care of, and that was very important to me. I mean, at the time, don't forget, I was being sued for $2 billion at one point.
By her?
By her.
Right.
And that was going to be a nasty, contentious suit, and frankly, had I not had a glitch, I would probably not be on this program right now. I'd be at divorce court.
If you hadn't had what? Oh, if you hadn't been down
had
into
to
the
bottom.
If you hadn't bottomed out and put some pressure on her and her attorney.
It wasn't a question of pressure. I mean, there was a point where she probably felt I wasn't going to make it. I mean, there was a point where a lot of people felt I wasn't going to make it except me. I really felt I was.
Were you telling her differently that maybe?
Telling her anything. All she had to do was read the New York Times and the Wall Street Journal. I mean, they were making these dire predictions about me and others, but I guess I got more print than anybody else. That's the negative. I mean, the good is when you're doing well. And they do that. The bad is when you're doing bad, they do it the other way, all right? And they did it the other way times 10. So what happened is, had I not been involved in a glitch, I don't believe that we would be here right now. I would be studying for tomorrow's examination before trial, okay? And what happened,
it got... You would have duked it out in a lawsuit.
Well, I think Ivana probably would have gone further than she did. But it got so bad, and the stories began getting so bad, that she said, boy, I better take, you know, what I'm entitled to according to the contract that we had signed. And she ended up taking the $10 million plus to this plus to that, and it's probably a package of $20 or $25 million. And I think she was smart in doing it in the end. I think her lawyers were horrendous. I think she was horribly represented. She could have gotten a lot more money earlier if she had decent lawyers, but she had lawyers
She could have gotten a lot more money
At an earlier stage.
You would have been more amenable to giving more money in a settlement.
I offered more money than she ended up getting, but Ivana, who is somebody that I'll always love, she decided in her great wisdom to hire these characters that were just looking for fame and fortune for themselves, in my opinion. And they did a bad job for her. They really did. And my folks did a great job for me. I had a wonderful lawyer who did a great job for me. And in the end, though, I'm saddened by it, because I would have preferred the initial deal with Ivana. She was very, very poorly represented in this divorce action.
You must have some sensitivity, though, for a woman in what she might be going through. I mean, you seem all powerful there, and she doesn't know, and she has to lean on the advice that she gets. And you know, people are saying, this guy's got a lot, tons of money. And
She was leaning on the Wall Street Journal. I mean, you know, when the bad stories started coming out, she was believing those stories. And she should have believed those stories. I'm not even saying the stories were wrong. You know, I've done things, but I'm not saying those stories at the time were wrong. The economy was atrocious, and you know, the business was bad, and the real estate business was horrendous, and the casino business was bad, and we're opening up the Taj Mahal in the middle of a war.
Right.
Okay, you know, I mean, I'm opening the largest building in the world
and
in the middle of a war.
People were not flooding Atlantic City at that time.
Well, no, I mean, everyone's sitting home watching the war.
And also, she's reading about you and another woman. That can't be pleasing.
Well, she's reading, and I never left for another woman. I mean, this is one of the great misconceptions. I left because I got tired of the balls and tired of the ballroom gowns and all the nonsense.
What does that mean?
Well, I'm just one that doesn't necessarily believe. You know, they call them the so-called charity events, but the people that have these charity events are probably the least charitable people I've ever met. And they have them for their own, you know, vilification. They have them for their own, whatever it is, they have them for their own. And they want the press, and they want the nonsense.
But why do we care if it generates a lot of money for charity?
I'm not sure that it does. I'm really not sure that it does. I mean, I look at some of them, and I look at the expense, and I look at the magnificent table settings at the Plaza Hotel, and which I'm very happy about, but at the Plaza Hotel and all the other places. And in the end, I don't think they make a hell of a lot for charity. And then I look at United Way, where the man's paid, you know, virtually millions of dollars to run United Way. Sure. And I look at what happens in charities.
Turns
I mean, I study charities, and there are very few well-run charities.
So you got tired of the gowns and the ball and all
I
that
stuff? I got tired of the scene, and yeah. I knew the scene, and I knew the people, and some of the people I like, in all fairness, and some of the people they don't like. They're a vicious breed.
You know someone listened to that, would just hear you say that, say, that's not what happened. This was a guy who was on top of the world, and he wanted to have his cake and eat it too. He wanted to date a lot of young, attractive women who viewed him as a giant catch.
You know, an interesting man to be with. I'm out now, and it's great. I have to tell you, I really like it. I think it's great.
Tell me what's great about it.
I just like it. I mean, for whatever it is. Maybe I shouldn't like it.
The freedom, the independence.
It's a freedom. It's a freedom. I can do what I want. I can be with who I want to be with. I really like it, and I would tell you if I didn't. And by the way, I think at a certain point, I won't like it. I'll get tired of it.
At a certain point, you'll say, I want to settle down with one person?
At a certain point, I think I'll say that. I think I'll say that very strongly. But, you know, at this point, I do like it. I had a fabulous wife in many respects.
Great kids.
Fantastic children, great children. I love them, and so therefore, that was so worthwhile. I had another friend later who was also fantastic for a fairly long period of time. And I just didn't want to settle down. I mean, I didn't want to get married. I didn't want to marry Marla. And I didn't want to settle down. And I'm just not ready for it. It's just not me. I mean, it's not right now. At some point...
Is that what killed that relationship then?
Well, a lot of things perhaps killed it. But I would say that probably that's the predominant thing. I mean, I was very antsy. I didn't want to settle. And of course, don't forget, you know, I'm busy. I'm doing a lot of different things. And I love doing it. I'm so happy now. You know, it's... I enjoy getting up and going out to the wars, and the wars are now becoming battles, and it's just worked out well. But you can't devote lots of time to a relationship when you're going through this.
There is also said in this piece by Julia Baumgartel that you love the limelight, and that you seek in the public and the public's adulation something, that the mirror of that is somehow important, confirming, true?
I don't think so. I think that I loved it at one point. I think I've gotten used to it. I think I do well in it. Well, I look at it differently. It's great for my business. I mean, the fact is that my casinos are up more than, as you know, my casinos are up more than any casinos in the United States. We're up number 1, 2, and 3 in increases in Atlantic City. Number 1, 2, and 3 every month.
But are they at the same time, and I don't want to hammer at this question, at the same time the most profitable? It's one thing to be up in revenue, and you're saying they're up in revenue. You're not necessarily saying that they are the most profitable.
The Taj Mahal has the largest gross operating profit of any casino in Atlantic City by far.
So when you factor in expenses, it has the gross.
It also has the biggest gross. I mean, it's got the biggest gross, but it's got the largest gross operating profit in Atlantic City. But what's happening is a lot of people, now I will say this, when people thought I was going down, they sort of deserted me. And this is not the way it should be.
But tell me who deserted you.
No. I'm talking about customers. I'm not only talking about, you know, friends, this, that. When the customers, the Taj Mahal customer, when the customers, the casino customers, even the condominium buyer customers, when they thought I was going down for the count, they really did desert me, I have to say. Now that they see I'm doing well again, now that they see I'm back, now that they see all these crazy magazine covers, I will tell you, one of the reasons that my casinos are up so much more is that they're all coming back.
But are you saying, though, therefore, it makes sense for you to promote this notion? I mean, look at this picture here. I mean, you like this.
Isn't he a handsome
guy? You like this, don't you?
No, I don't
but
really.
But is it good for
sure
you
like
to promote that because it says Donald is back and all of this stuff about scrambles off the canvas, in a sense, is good for business.
So therefore, you're promoting that image. You want people to believe
that you're back.
I mean, as an example, it's late in the evening right now. It's not that you're a fantastic guy, and we did this down in New Orleans, but in New Orleans it was during the afternoon. It was really much more pleasant. Now it's late in the evening, and here we are doing an interview.
Yeah, right.
It happens.
A heck of an interview it is.
I hope we're going to have a good time. I mean, I hope you get good ratings, too.
I do, too.
Anything for you, Joe.
Yeah, exactly.
But I'll tell you what, it happens
Poor
to boy
be... Poor boy from the North. Yeah, go ahead.
That's right. It happens to be great for business. I mean, the fact that it's coming back. Now, it would be nice if it were the other way. Yeah. If you have problems, wouldn't it be nice
all
if
right,
everyone...
But apart from all that, come on. Ego.
I have an ego.
Of course you do.
I've never met a successful person.
Nor have I. Nor have I. People are driven by it. I mean, Mother Teresa has an ego.
Absolutely.
You know,
so you're bigger than you would ever believe.
Well, I've never had the pleasure. But nevertheless, I mean, part of it, you love the limelight. You love beyond the business and what it does and the whole sense of the Trump image. You like it. You like the fact that there's security guys coming ahead of you and sweeping behind you, and there's this adulation, and women want to be with you, and wherever you go, there are flashbulbs and all of this kind of thing. You like it.
I don't mind it. I don't mind it.
No, don't mind it or relish it?
I'll tell you what, I used to like it more. I still like it.
Yeah.
I probably would miss it if it weren't here.
Yeah, because
I probably would. No, I probably would.
Because you've grown accustomed to it as part of your...
Maybe. I have grown. You know, it's been sort of wild. But I also think it's great for business. I mean, it is great for the casino business. It's great for the condominium business. It's great. Hey, they just came out with a report, the Corcoran Report, that Trump apartments in New York sell for more on a square foot basis, which is really the only... than any apartments in New York... by far. It's not even close.
Let me
talk. A lot of that is all of this nonsense.
Let me talk about people you ought to say sorry to, if there might be. One is, and I'm talking, one, I raised this person first, that guy in Philadelphia, you know, who they say you got fired. You remember the guy who did the stock analysis?
Well, I don't have to say sorry. He did great. I mean, he came out, he did well, and now he's biggest champion.
Okay, but
you know, he's the one.
But you got him fired. You got to look back.
I can't help that his firm fired him. If they fired
him, come on. Did they fire him because of a call from you?
I have no idea.
Okay.
Really, I have
no
idea.
But don't you have any regret
Perhaps.
For that? I mean, one man may have lost a job because you leaned on his...
Because he's a tough guy. He's a savvy guy. He's come out great. He's a stock analyst, and he's now my biggest champion. He's saying it's the greatest comeback. In fact, he used the word brilliant. I hate to tell you this.
What's his name?
His name is Marvin Rothman.
That's right.
And he was a great critic of me, and now he's saying that this was one of the most brilliant things he's ever
seen. So you did him a favor by getting him fired?
Well, I think in the long run, I think he's probably doing better now than
he was
doing
then. So you did him a favor, that's so.
Indirectly, I did him a favor. I wasn't looking to do him a favor, but I think indirectly.
But don't you regret that? I mean, you
know. No, I don't regret it.
Did this guy lose his job?
No, because that's life. You can't look back. I don't like look back.
No regrets then? I mean, there's no one that you'd say now?
No regrets. If I had it to do again, would I have done things differently? Yes.
What would you have done differently?
I probably, instead of stopping with the sale of the St. Moritz, where I sold and I made a lot of money, I probably would have sold some other things.
I would have treated
people differently. I think that, you know, some of the people that were most loyal to me are people that I didn't think would be. Some of the people that were least loyal to me are people that I think I would have treated them differently. I think I would have treated different groups differently. I would have wiped the floor with the guys that weren't loyal, which I will now do, which is great. You know, I love getting even with people. But I will.
No,
I
slow
will
up. Wipe. You love getting even.
Oh, absolutely. You don't believe in the eye for the eye. You do.
No.
I know you well enough. I think you do. But anyway.
Tell me. I mean, you're going to get even with some people.
Yeah, I know. If given the opportunity, I will get even with some people that were disloyal to me. I mean, I had a group of people that were disloyal.
But how do you define disloyalty?
They didn't come to my aid.
Well, what did they do? They turned their back on you?
No, but they didn't do small things that would have helped. They didn't do large.
Give me one example.
Well, I had a one man who frankly was on the board of a company that I was selling, and it was a tremendous sale for me. It was a great sale. Would have been a very helpful sale, and it ended up going through. But one of the things is that I had
this
to take
was Shuttle?
No, this was a different company. Okay. It doesn't matter which company. And it was a great thing for me. But one of the things is I had to clear the board. Now, I only put him on that board because of the fact I thought I was doing him a favor. He got some money by being a board member, et cetera, et cetera. He contributed nothing. When it came time, I have five board members. When it came time to be to removing the slate and getting all my people, everyone said, I'm leaving.
Right.
Steve Ballenbach, Harvey Freeman, everyone left. Except this one particular person said, I don't want to leave. He told my people, I don't want to leave. Well, when I heard about it, I went nuts. And I blasted him. And all of a sudden, he left. But I consider that a great act of disloyalty. I put him on that board. Now, he did leave. I mean, he did leave. It's a little like Andrew. I mean, Andrew ended up in favor of Riverside South, but for all I had done, I had never asked him for anything. This is a great job. This is a job that he should have been in favor. He had to do a poll in order to find out whether or not he was going to support
it. But how can you get even with Andy Stein? I mean, his guys...
It's not a question of getting even. I can certainly be disappointed in certain people, and I was very disappointed.
Yeah, but you've already said an eye for an eye. I mean, he hits you, you're going to hit him back.
Well, I might.
Yeah, but how could you hit him back?
We'll see. Hey, time will tell, I guess, right?
Are you looking for the opportunity?
No, I'm not looking. I'm just really so disappointed in him. I'm disappointed in other people.
Who?
And I was disappointed in this one man that didn't want to get off the board.
Right.
Now, he got off.
Okay, but he got off.
He got off after being hit over the head with a cannon, okay?
What was the cannon?
The Cannon was me. And he ended up...
What was the threat, though? I mean, did you blast him in the paper and that was enough?
No, or did you say... The threat was just sort of a strong threat. I mean, he would have gone through a lot of hell if he didn't get off. And then he gets off and he acts like he does me a favor. He gets off, okay? He got off maybe out of fear.
You owe me, Donald, because I'm getting off the board.
Yeah, and, you know, it was like one of the great jokes of the century. But it ended up that he got off and the deal went through. But that doesn't mean I have to love this particular guy. It doesn't mean I have to love him. I want somebody that's loyal from the beginning, not somebody that's loyal because they're afraid or because they're this or because they're that. And I've had a lot of instances like that. But I think, you know, and again, I think the new book, and I don't know why I'm promoting a book that's not going to come out for 3 or 4 months. I mean, I don't want to waste a lot of time. Yeah, but I think that the most interesting aspect, that's right, we'll do it when you go national.
That's
okay,
right.
We'll do that for the national. Forget the local stuff.
But the local stuff's important. Without the local stuff, there'd be no national stuff.
You don't do the second step.
Exactly.
But the truth is, I think the most interesting aspect of that book is the loyalty area, the loyalty chapters. I think
now,
it's
you,
really good.
You measure loyalty in terms of your own relationship with Roy Cohn. You stuck by Roy Cohn. And
I think you showed
your stripes by doing that.
Well, I don't think I showed my stripes. I think, you see, I'm so loyal to people, and maybe I'm loyal to a fault, but I'm so loyal to people that when somebody's slightly disloyal to me, I look upon it as a great act of horror.
Who are you going to support for mayor?
Well, I think David Dinkins, I have to tell you, has done a real good comeback. You know, you talk about comebacks. David Dinkins has done one hell of a comeback in the last 6 months. And you saw what happened in Los Angeles, and you saw what happened. People really like the man. I mean, I've been with him, and I've watched him. And he has really become a very popular guy. And I think he's going to be very hard to beat in a lot of ways. Now, I have to tell you that a year and a half ago, nobody wanted to run against George Bush. It took a man from Arkansas who was the only one, you know, virtually one of the few people that wanted to run. Because George Bush was unbeatable. There was no way you could beat this guy. And he turned out to, you know, he just ran out of gas.
It looked like David Dinkins couldn't possibly win re-election a year ago, and then you had Los Angeles, a lot of other things, and now he's in a much better position to poll
safe. Well, he really is. He's done a great comeback.
You support him over Giuliani.
Well, I'm not announcing who I'm supporting, and I don't think it's even relevant. I just think that Dinkins has really done a great job in terms of coming back. And I also think he's a great human being. I think he's a very fine...
Did he help you on the Planning Commission?
He helped me, but he was tough. He was strong. He was very community-oriented. He was very much for the people in that sense. But when he gave me his word that he would now support the job, he really lived up to that word.
There was also a guy on the political scene this year named Ross Perot, a billionaire. Were you once a billionaire?
I was projected as being a billionaire.
Yeah, I know you were, but you never can tell
times.
About those numbers.
I mean,
you were worth a couple, because I saw that at least $900 million, but...
No.
Did you actually have
no,
a net worth of
I guess they had me up to the
billion?
Highest of two.
What did you have yourself up to?
I don't know. I had myself up to maybe what I have right now. I don't know. Nobody knows what I'm worth. What's the Taj Mahal worth? What's the West Side?
I don't know.
I have no idea what I'm worth.
What was it you used to say about the Plaza? You said this is a trophy. Therefore, it's a different place if it's
no,
a trophy.
If it's the
best and unique, then people pay a premium for the best and unique.
But people don't buy trophies so much anymore.
Yeah, that's true.
1998 trophies were great. 1990, you don't talk
about. Did you pay too much for that trophy? Probably.
No, I'll tell you what, when I bought the Plaza, I was offered a huge profit a year after, and brilliantly I decided not to take that profit, okay?
And who sold it to you? Was it the Basses on
that? It was a consortium of people.
But the Basses were involved?
And I have to tell you, truthfully, I'm very happy with my purchase of the Plaza Hotel. I think it's working out fantastically. I think it's going to work out. You know, adversity is a very funny thing. When you have adversity, it's like in golf, it's like in sports. Everybody, it's a question of how many bad shots do you hit? Not so many good shots, but how many bad shots?
In other words, minimize your bad shots.
You really have to, it's not a question of getting, because everybody's going to get in trouble. It's a question of how do you get out of trouble.
Yeah, but
I think the Plaza Hotel is going to turn out to be a great deal for me. I mean, it's already turning out to be a great deal for me.
But
golf, I think it's going to be great.
That sporting metaphor may be correct, because in golf, if you were playing and you got to go over the water to reach the green, sometimes you don't make it over the water.
Well, sometimes you don't.
And then it can
but I'm not
put you into a bogey land.
Sure, but hey, but that's not where I am, although I could have.
You're not in bogey land now? Well, but are you back to par? You're not even back to par, though. You're at least a bogey.
I think, again, I tell you this, and I make this prediction, I think in 6 months I'll be stronger than I was 3 or 4 years ago, whatever my...
That's a birdie, isn't it?
I believe what I did is I restructured things in the early 90s and the bad times, and now it's turning out to be very good. I believe that I'll be stronger than I was 2 years ago, but who knows? I mean, let's see what happens. Let's see what happens with the economy. Let's see what happens with the
world. Ross Perot had $3 billion, was willing to spend it, and got something, I haven't seen the last tally, maybe 17-18% of the vote, 19% of the vote. There was a time in which you wanted to tease America that you might be want to run for president.
Well, people said that. I never did, but people said that.
You didn't go to New Hampshire to test the water.
You know
didn't, under the influence of Roger Stone, say, you know, this is an interesting idea. Let's go up and see what we can do.
I really went to New Hampshire because they wanted me to go to New Hampshire and they wanted
but
me to
But you knew that your appearance there would generate
well,
the talk.
I certainly did generate talk. And
but
I
you
didn't
knew
do
that
it.
Your appearance would generate
no,
talk.
No, I didn't do
and
it for that reason. Charlie, I didn't do it for that reason, and I had no idea how much talk would be generated, and I had no intention of running for president, and I wouldn't have an intention of running for president. I will say this, Ross Perot, he made some monumental mistakes. Had he not dropped out of the election, had he not made the gaffes about, you know, the watchdogs and the guard dogs and everybody coming
stuff.
At the house, and,
he
you know, three or four, if he didn't have three or four bad days, and they were real bad days, he could have conceivably won this crazy election.
You'll get some political people who are smarter than you and I both about politics who will say the same thing.
Oh, I believe
that
it.
He could have made it a very competitive race.
He was up to 42 points at one.
But at the same time, whatever it is that made him generate $2 billion, which enabled him to do as well as he did in part. He was very effective in the debates, and that had nothing to do with how much money he had.
Right.
At the same time, maybe, you know, you have to take the good with the bad, and part of the personality makeup that happened to make him $2 billion also made him the way he is about sort of the paranoia about
Well, the paranoia
others.
Maybe created some of the money, but it's not necessarily good
Or the
politics.
Drive that creates both.
See, one of the problems with politics and politicians is that you really can't have done very much wrong, and that means you can't have done very much. Because if you're doing a lot, hey, I do a lot of things, and most of them turn out good, but some of them have to turn out bad. And it's, you know, they'll hit you with a little bad, and it makes it a little bit more difficult.
Franklin Roosevelt, I think, once said, Arthur Schlesinger was here the other night, and I'm not sure he said this, but I think that FDR once said, I'm proud of all my enemies, I've earned them. What enemies are you proud of?
Well, I'm proud of having a guy like Ed Koch as an enemy because I think he's a major loser. He did a lousy job as mayor. He's a promoter. He's very much of a promoter. He did not do a good job as a mayor. He got very upset because after 8 years of trying to build the Wollman skating rink, I was able to do it in 4 months for about 1/10 the money that they spent. And instead of thanking me, he took great umbrage to the fact that I was able to do this. And I just wanted to have my kids go ice skating in Central Park. I got tired of watching these people sitting on their I'm not allowed to say asses in this program, so of course I won't say it. But I got tired of watching these people just sitting down and not working and not doing it right and having no planning and no leadership. So instead of thanking me and saying, Donald, it was a great job, he went around saying, well, I think we could have done it if we this, if we that. He was not.
So Ed Koch, who else?
I think he was just
an underrated guy. What other enemy are you proud of?
I'm not proud of enemies. I'd like to have, you know, I'm the kind of guy that has great friends and great enemies and somehow. But I'm not proud of him.
Is your father still the seminal influence in your life?
Well, I have a great father. I have a wonderful father. He's somebody I love very much. I wouldn't say he is. I'd say my mother and father maybe is a
together
combination.
Or
yeah, together because I have just.
And what way did they influence you differently?
Well, they're very different people. My father's a very business-oriented guy, but a very good man. I mean, if somebody came up to my father on the street and said, I need $100, I need $200. And my father is the softest touch when it comes to people that really are in trouble. He's really a very great humanitarian in that sense. But he's a strong man. People would think of him as being cold, but he's not cold at all. My mother is openly warm. I mean, she's just a wonderful
woman. Except when it comes to Mike Tyson.
Except when it came to Mike Tyson. It took 40 years, and finally she came out and she said something. But she's a fabulous
She made
woman.
You like yourself when you were growing up.
She
I mean,
really
by
did.
Her love reinforced your sense of self.
She really did. I mean, she's some woman.
Greenberg, again, in this New York Magazine article, said about you, he said, if Donald gives you his word, it's good as gold. However, he said,
he said that sometimes I have a bad memory.
that leaves you wide open wide open to the fact that.
And I have a photographic memory.
Well,
that's the problem.
Exactly. I mean, it raises this question, can you trust what Donald really says? Because his memory may be short.
Yeah. Now, I think he meant that jokingly. He's a great friend and he's a great gentleman. And I think he meant that I think, but perhaps he's had some bad experiences. I really don't know.
What brings you the greatest satisfaction now? Is it conquering adversity or is it something else?
Well, I used to think just continued success, but I got bored by it.
Yeah, enough now, and enough is not
enough. Enough. And then I really think that right now I'm just really proud with the way I've handled things. I really think that I've handled things well from a business standpoint.
And somebody who steps forward and says, you know, this is just Donald's hype. He's a giant promoter. He hasn't come back. I mean, times have turned a little bit around. You know, sold off some assets, but it's not the great comeback that he believes it is.
Well, all they have to do is look at the numbers. I mean, you look at the numbers in the casino journals, and you look at the numbers, and, you know, it's been a tremendous comeback. And I'm not saying I'm as far back as I will be in 6 months. I mean, I'm back, and I'm not in any trouble, and I'm doing well, and I'm making money.
What do you think?
Money is a scorecard for me. You know, money is not as important as people would think it would be to a guy like me, but it is a scorecard. And You know, I've really
So what is the most important thing to a guy like you?
I think the way I've survived, the quality in which I've lived under the survival mode, the image I've portrayed during the survival period. I mean, people haven't seen me go into a corner and put my thumb in my mouth and say, I give up. I mean, this kid doesn't give up. And some people did give up, I have to tell you, Charlie. And you know, you're not going to be doing interviews with them. But some people did give up. Many people gave up, and many tough, smart killers gave up. They just gave up. They said, I can't do it anymore. So I think the way in which I survived was very important to me.
Art of the Comeback, soon to be out. We're going to be out next beginning of 1999?
Three or four months.
Yeah. You're writing this alone?
I'm doing this one alone because I really want to get my flavor. I've had two wonderful writers. My other books were both number one bestsellers. Yeah. I'm doing this alone. I want to get my own flavor. It's really become somewhat of a passion because I think people are going to learn a lot from it.
Good to have you.
Have a good time.
Thanks very much.
Thank you.
Donald Trump is back. Thank you for joining us tonight. Monday we'll talk with World Series hero Dave Winfield. Trump would like to hear that. Also, a lot of other people will be here. We're taping next week an hour with Charlie Kuralt, one of my friends from North Carolina. A lot more interesting things coming up. See you Monday.